Last time we left our algebra lecture with the solution to the quadratic equation, which I remind you is an equation of this type. The quad from quadratic comes from square. It is a very important equation, so important actually that it wouldn't hurt us to look again at the solution. The general solution in terms of the quantity that are there is of this type. Doesn't matter where we put the minus sign because the plus minus just become a minus plus. We've got the discriminant below the square root, which is an important quantity because its sign being under the square root matters, and that will actually define the type of solution that we get for this quadratic equation. And it is an old venerable equation which has been addressed since antiquity. Actually, I believe that even Babylonian people from Mesopotamia were addressing this type of equation. You might have seen certainly these little stones that are carved with these cuneiform shapes, and in some of them, well, what people have identified is actually things that look like problems of computation of areas, maybe even for school children and this kind of thing. And this equation came to be solved in a fairly comprehensive manner by Al-Khwarizmi with his method of reunion of the broken parts. And then the solution happened in books from the Middle Ages literature. One very important book come from the Muslim Spain, where there was a scholar, a Jewish scholar, who first wrote down the most general, generic type of solution to the quadratic equation. And after that, the problem became to solve the next higher order of solution, which means a cubic equation of this type, where there is a cube term. And interestingly, it took a lot of time for people to start to get an idea of how to solve this equation. Actually, it brings us to the Italian Renaissance, so we are speaking late 15th, 16th century, where someone by the name of Scipione del Ferro actually found a trick that we are going to see in a few minutes for solving this equation. But, and that's the interesting part, he didn't want to reveal this trick, he didn't want to make it public, so he kept it secret. And fortunately, he didn't die with him, it was passed to a student, someone who was called Fior, and this Fior had a row, he had some argument with another Italian scholar of his time, who was called Tartaglia. And Tartaglia, I found a solution of a particular type of a cubic equation, namely equation of this type, where we are using this time m and n rather than a and b for the variables. And Fior, who thought he was kind of superior because he had access to the more general knowledge, challenged his opponent to, I believe, something like 40 problems that he had to solve in under a week or something like that. And legend has it, or history has it, I don't know how much of it is true, that Tartaglia could solve all the problems in under 2 hours, because he reconstructed, he could find by himself independently the solution of Scipione del Ferro. Which shows, by the way, that you should never keep a scientific discovery secret, because again, it's not something that you invent, it's something that you find, and it's something you can find, somebody else can find it again, and then somehow you lose priority of it. At the same time, there was another scholar, this time in Bologna, someone by the name of Cardano, was writing a very important text that marked his epoch. It was called the Ars Magna. And he wanted Cardano to put the solution, not only of the quadratic equation, which was well known since a long time ago, already books that were existing on this topic. He wanted to put the state of the art, including the solution of the cubic equation. So he begged Tartaglia to share with him the technique to solve the equation. And Tartaglia, even though he was reluctant at first, he also wanted to keep the technique secret, but maybe because he understood the danger of having Cardano or somebody else find it again, he agreed to say what was the technique, under the condition that he would have the priority of publishing it himself first. But Cardano, who initially agreed on that, he at some point understood or realized that the solution was not the invention of Tartaglia, but that Scipione del Ferro and his student Fior knew the technique before, actually, Tartaglia. And then Cardano understood that this was relieving him from his promise, and he published independently, without Tartaglia publishing it first, he published the solution in his Ars Magna. Interestingly, he also published the solution using kind of the same idea, same technique, because once he knew the technique, he could study it further to better and apply it to more problems. He also published the solution to the quartic equation, so something that involves the fourth power of the variable, was done not by Cardano himself, but by one of his students, who comes by the name of Ferrari. It's a name that you will hear about when you look at solution to quartic equations. And we are going to look at the solution of the cubic equation, which is a question of this type. It's not the most general type. We remove the square here. That's the one that Tartaglia could solve in the second step, because this is actually general enough by a change of variable to bring you to the most general type of cubic equation with four parameters, A, B, C, D for the cube, the square, the single variable, and the constant. So what is the solution to solve this? Well, it all relies on this identity that you obtain by expanding the cube of the difference. So I let you compute this. We know how to do it already. I will go directly to the result that A minus B to the cube. We can bring this term there that we factorize, and this is equal to the difference of the cube. You can check that. So if we compare it to the previous equation, you see that if we call m like this, and if we call n like this, then you find that a minus b is a solution to this equation. Therefore, we are brought to two new equations, which is 3ab equal m and a cube minus b cube equal n. If you solve these two equations, then finding a and b that with this combination provide you m and n, it will make you a minus b the solution of this equation by the feature of this remarkable identity. So we have to solve this equation, which we can do actually fairly easily. We can substitute, for instance, we can write b from the first equation as m divided by 3a, that substituted into the second equation give us a cube minus the cube of this is m cube divided by 3 to the cube is 27, a cube equal n. And now if you multiply everybody by a cube to get rid of this a cube that becomes a new variable in the denominator, it gives us a 6 minus m cube over 27. This becomes the constant, and this term here is actually another term that has the variable. So that's a new equation that looks even more complicated because now it has the power 6, but actually we can write it in this form: a cube square minus a cube n minus m cube over 27 equals 0. And here, I mean, we can substitute this quantity here, this unknown a, by something else. So let's call it this a cube y. Then it becomes y. So what do we have here? We've got a quadratic equation for y. This we can solve using this solution. And then we can take the cubic power of this. This is something that people knew how to do already. And from that we know a, then we know b, and knowing a and b, then we found the solution as a minus b. So I let you fill in the missing steps. It's quite straightforward once you get the trick. That was the big secret of Tartaglia and of Scipione del Ferro, which was published by revealed by Cardano in his Arc Magna. So we don't look at the solution of Ferrari, but it's the same kind of idea, just more complicated, and there is more steps to take into account. You can see that people spent a lot of time trying to solve this. If you are interested to know what happened with the quintic, then the history becomes even more interesting, but we will leave this for another time. The main point is that it stops there. The closed form solution stops at the quartic equation. So, having said that, once Cardano had put this solution into his book, there is an important and interesting fact, is that the negative numbers were not, at this time of Cardano, actually that popular or that accepted, so that they were easily included or taken into account in the algebraic manipulation. In fact, Cardano was solving these two equations with a and b both positive. He was looking at these as independent equations that had to be solved using different tricks. Actually, he was devoting independent chapters to this two equation in this Ars Magna. He had 13 possible configuration, and this makes 13 chapters in the book to address all the possible cases. While from a modern perspective, we see that this is the same equation, just this term goes on the other side and we've got a minus sign here. But Cardano didn't look at the minus sign straightforwardly, so innocently. For him, it was there was some tricks involved. And actually, he started to notice that strange things were happening with the sign, especially when with the square root of the sign. He devoted his 37, let's see if we remember well our Roman numerals, his 37th chapter in Ars Magna is devoted to possibly what is his major contribution. Besides the book himself, he made this very important acuitus and central crucial observation, which is the topic of this lecture, that if you would apply blindly, mechanically, the rules of algebra, regardless of the numbers that are involved, if they make sense or not, if you can represent them or understand them, then there is some sort of internal consistency. It still works, it still leads you to somewhere without breaking anything, without resulting in inconsistency or paradoxes. Mainly, the problem that he addressed or that he used to illustrate the problem was the following one. Take a string of length 10. And then the point is that you have to find a point where you will bind this thing to form an area here of length 40. That was the problem. So if we call x with modern notation, x the point where you would bind your string to form this circle, then it becomes fairly simple because this length here by definition is this one, which is the total minus x, therefore this is 10 minus x. So the area that we've got there, it is 10 minus x, x. And this we want that it is equal to 40. That's the problem, this Babylonian looking problem that Cardano is looking at in his chapter 37. And this is a quadratic equation because we can expand it. That's 10x equal 40. Let's change the sign and bring everybody on the same side so that it looks like a modern quadratic equation. We can solve it using our solutions that are written there. That's x equal minus b, which is minus 10, plus or minus square root of b square, which is 100, minus 4ab, that's 4 times 40, that's 160, divided by 2a, so by 2 because a is equal to 1. This minus here, we can get rid of it if we put it there. That gives us 5, if I divide by 2. This plus or minus becomes minus plus, but we don't care about the order of the solution, so I can keep it plus minus. And then we've got the square root of 100 minus 160 is negative, that's minus 60. And 60 is 4 times 15, right? It's 2 times 2 times... this 15 is 30, so that's 60, that's right. Therefore, the square root of 60 is the square root of 4, which is 2 times 15. We've got the minus there. So Cardano, that's the main observation he makes in his chapter 37, said, okay, we're going to keep it, so I will put it like this. I will say that it's 2, that I divide by the 2 in the denominator. I'm left with minus 15. That's my two solutions. You see them here written in the Ars Magna. You see, by the way, as well, the interesting notation they had at this time. You don't have this plus minus square root and everything. So what we read here is 5PRM15. The numbers are the same. They come from the Arabs or the Indians, however you want to interpret it. P and M below is for plus minus, which we got there. Then we got the R, which stands for root, and the M, which is for minus. And below, I let you decipher that the product indeed solves the problem. Because that's precisely what I want to tell you. If we look at the application of this, if we multiply these two distances, so one is supposedly this one, that could be this one, for instance, so that's 5 plus square root of minus 15, and here we've got 5 minus square root of minus 15. Okay, so it's that's the point that Cardano realized already. It doesn't make sense to speak of this distance. It doesn't exist. It used this concept of square root of negative number that is not defined. But he says, okay, even that the solution is not physical, doesn't exist, you cannot find the, cannot put my finger on the point that would make it work. The algebra works, the calculation works, because let's compute indeed the area of this strange rectangle which is formed with the sides that have this respective distance. We apply the common rules of algebra, we've got 25. This and this would cancel, because that's 5 square root minus 15 minus 5 square root minus 15, so they cancel, and you are left with minus 15 square. And here, using the rules of algebra that tells us that the square root of a number is this quantity which multiplied by itself gives the number, then we are indeed, we find that this is minus 15 by applying again blindly, mechanically, the rules of algebra. Minus minus is plus, and 25 plus 15 is 30 plus 10 is 40. Right? So that solves the problem. So Cardano comments on this operation that involves fictitious quantity, the square root of a negative number, but that still solves the equation. There he makes a very nice observation which goes along the line that it is as subtle than it is useless, this observation. But actually it is not useless. It was not for Cardano himself to raise this algebra to the statue that deserves the importance that it has nowadays. It was for people that came after him, in particular, I believe, Fibonacci. And other people like Euler, who decided that we could introduce this new number, I, we are going to use the letter I for it, for something which some people like to call the square root of minus 1. So we tend to discourage this notation because we will see later on when we look in more detail at this that there are several solutions to the square root of complex numbers. So it's possibly ill-defined. It's not the most elegant or rigorous way to do it. So instead of this, we prefer to have I, the number defined such a way that I square when multiplied to itself is minus 1. And clearly this number I is of a new type. It's not a number that we find in R, for instance. Yeah? Because all the numbers in R, if we multiply them by themselves, by the rules of algebra, are positive numbers. Therefore, we introduce a new set, a new class of numbers that we will call the complex numbers. We note them with these things. And they are of this type. A complex number is a number, so we can write it like this, which is a form from a real part. We call that the real part. And then another part, which is the one that is attached to this I, this new number, this new quantity. Can call it a number, even though it's not an Arabic numeral. It's a quantity whose square is equal to minus 1. And then the beautiful thing here, what we have to appreciate, is this thing of Cardano, even though he didn't himself value it too much, the result, but he encouraged us to do that, is that applying blindly or mechanically, I want to say stupidly, but systematically, the rules of algebra, we are led to work to manipulate some universe, Platonic universe, which is consistent. It works. It leads us to discover new things. We are not breaking anything by doing that, as we are going to demonstrate. In particular, we are going to show that if we take two numbers, Z1 and Z2, that are in C, then we can define an algebra of this number in the sense that we can speak of their sum or their multiplication. These are new complex numbers. We are not creating, we don't need another quantity which would be J or K with new properties to complement the fact that we added something in algebra, a new quantity which square is equal to minus 1. So let us show this. We are going to define Z1 as X1 plus IY1 and similarly Z2 as X2 plus IY2, where X1, X2, Y1, and Y2 are all numbers that belong to R, or real numbers. So that's the definition of complex numbers. We've got two of them. And if we look at the sum, for instance, we've got, by definition, so that's Z1 plus Z2. I'm just substituting the definition I gave to this number. Now here, Cardano's precept. Let's apply the rules of algebra that we are familiar with for the numbers. Even though we've got this new quantity I. We are familiar with what? We are familiar with associativity, which tells us that we can remove the parentheses here. And we are familiar with commutativity, which tells us that we can move around the quantity. So I can put this X2 there, and we can do it like this. This is commutativity, right? Okay. And now what do we find just by applying these two rules is that indeed now, using commutativity again, and we are going to factorize the I. So here I'm using the law of distributivity of the product involving this I with the addition. Here we have that Z1 plus Z2 is also a complex number because by definition, it is something which is of the form a complex number plus I, a real number plus I another real number. So it's the form a plus ib, if you want. Okay. The same can be said about the product, where here we've got slightly more interesting algebra. The starting point is the same. We still substitute z1 and z2. Then, Cardano's precept, we apply the usual algebra. So that's this, x1, x2, plus this, I. Let's do it in order. Let's not assume anything. So it's x1, I, y2. Then this, that's y1, x2. And then the last product is, I'm missing a I here. So I'm missing a I here in particular. And that's I, y1. And then let's make a bit of room. IY2. Now let's apply the rules of algebra that we are familiar with, which are associativity. You can get rid of the parentheses here, here, and also here. Then commutativity, which says that we can move the quantity around. So the doesn't allow us to break, of course, the variable in this way. Here I will leave it like that. Maybe we can change the order of x and y to have the x first. Everything is commutative, the real numbers, the complex numbers. So here I want only to move the I and bring it in front. Get this a bit closer. And now we compute. So for computation, what is interesting to do is to factorize the I, as we already did. You can check that this quantity that I wrote there, let's take a less aggressive color, is equal to this. And what do we do with this one? So here we've got II, which is I times I, really. I told you that numbers, we have to put the time sign. We cannot write 2, 7, because that's 27. So we write 2 times 7. If these are letters, however, we can write XY. There is no doubt, no risk of confusion there. For the complex number, just the same. We write 2I for what is really 2 times I. We don't need to put the times sign. It wins us time, it's more elegant, it's more pretty as well. It's prettier. We can do it as well for II, yeah? Or we could write this I square. And this is particularly good because this is what I should really put in a box. That's the most interesting property we discovered today. I square is equal to minus 1. Therefore, what I have here is minus y1, y2. Again, you see that I put my II here as the minus sign. Very good. So once we did this, the last thing to do is a bit of commutativity again of the addition, and then we have the final result, which is a plus ib. So that shows that the product of two complex numbers is a complex number because it is of the type real part plus I times imaginary part. This is very nice, and I invite you to check that this works like this for all the simple algebraic manipulation you can do, like the square, for instance, of two complex numbers, or the cube. Let's look at the cube of I, for instance. How would you compute the cube of I? Is it a complex number? Can I write it in the form a plus ib? Yes, we can, because I cube is I square times I, or I times I square. I square, you know, is minus 1, therefore I cube is minus I. And you can check like this, for instance, the binomial equation, n, where n is an integer. So I let you check all that you don't get outside of the realm of complex number. Everything that you do like this, all this manipulation, leave you with a number of the type a plus ib, or x plus iy. But how about things that might be a bit more sophisticated at first glance? Like, for instance, the ratio of two complex numbers. If I look at this quantity like this, is it clear? That's one here. I'm using the same notation as before. Is it clear that this I can write in the form a plus ib, for instance? So it might not be so obvious, actually. What does it mean to divide by a complex number? We've seen in our first algebra lecture that 1 over q, where q is an integer, is a number that you need to add to itself q times, so that gives you 1. P over q is the number you need to add to itself q times, so that gives you p. So what does it mean to add to yourself a complex number of time? It doesn't mean anything. So here we really need to rely on this Cardano principle of applying, extending, generalizing the rules of algebra to these new objects and see if it works. So to do that, to make sense of this quantity, we are going to introduce something really important, really useful as well, really powerful. It's mainly notation, but it's so important that we need to spend a little time to consider it. is the operation that consists in changing the sign of the part which has the I. So if this is my complex number Z, we will call it the complex conjugation. Conjugation, that's the complex conjugate. And what we do is that we change the sign here. This plus becomes a minus. It becomes a minus because that's the part that comes to the imaginary part. So it's just a notation, right? But it's really useful because this complex conjugate, what it does is that it gives us access to the x and y variable, to the skeleton of our complex number. Indeed, you can see that x, we can take it, you can obtain it from z alone, from the complex number itself, z, by adding it to x complex conjugate. Yes, let's go through it slowly. That's by definition like this, and you see that these two terms cancel. So actually we have to divide by 2 here because we are left with 2x divided by 2, that's x. So this quantity z plus z star divided by 2, we are going to call it the real part of z. You can show similarly that the imaginary part of z is equal to z minus z star. We need to subtract now to cancel the real part. Okay, if you subtract these two things, the common x cancels, and then we have to divide by 2i this time. Not importantly, divide by the I, that the imaginary part of a complex number is this, is not i y. We remove the I. So it might be counterintuitive, and I know that some students tend to complain about that, but the imaginary part is real. The imaginary part is a real number. It doesn't carry the I. The imaginary of I is 1. Because I is 0 plus 1 times I. Therefore, imaginary part of I is 1. Another thing, possibly even more important than the real and imaginary part that we obtain by manipulating the complex number and its conjugate, is to make their product. Z star, we can compute, it's x plus iy multiplied by its complex conjugate, so I change the sign of I here, and then maybe we can start to go a bit faster because we get used to this algebra. If it's not the case, take the time to do it slowly until you get familiar enough. We find that this is x squared. This I product will cancel, iyx minus iyx cancels, and we are left with plus iy times minus iy. And here we use the rules of always, that associativity, commutativity, we are left with minus I squared y squared. What is minus I squared? Well, we know that I square is equal to minus 1, minus minus 1 is equal to 1. So this is plus 1. Therefore, here we are left with plus. And this is also something really important. We have a notation for this. We call it the square of the modulus, or modulus square of this thing. And why it is important? Because it brings us this notion of distance, or length, or magnitude of the complex number. For the numbers that we have seen so far, in n or z, q and r, a good notion of distance would be the number itself. It tells you how big the quantity is. 7 is something that is it has this sort of size, and 10, and we get this. Problem is, some numbers can be negative, not in n, but in z already you got minus 2. And the negative numbers, we don't want the sign to be there in the when we speak of magnitude. Well, the magnitude is the size of it. If you've got minus 20 as a quantity in the bank, what's important is the 20. The minus just tell you that you owe this money to the bank. While if it's plus, it's the bank that owes you this money, principal. So the sign is qualitative, but the magnitude is the number itself. So for this, it's very simple. To get rid of the number, we put this absolute value, which is these two symbols, the absolute value of z. Just remove the sign, it chomps it out if it's there. Now it's a positive value. So we use the same notation for a complex number, but for a complex number, it's not only the sign, it's this I. We don't want to have any I in something which is a notion of distance, of length, of magnitude, of size. We don't want I there. We want a real positive number. So we will see in a little while, when we look at representation of complex number, that indeed is a good way to think of the size of a complex number by looking at this combination, the sum of the square. Particular, you see that it is zero only if both x and y is zero, which really looks like a zero complex number is when there is no real part and no imaginary part. If one of them is not zero, then this thing is not zero, right? So this is an important quantity, the modulus square, and this helps us to solve what we were discussing, which is, if you remember, this problem. So we copy it because we were looking there. We are looking at this problem before discussing all this complex conjugation. And now the complex conjugation will make it straightforward to solve the problem, because we were asking precisely if this quantity can be a complex number. Problem is that we got complex number in the denominator. We don't want to have the complex number in the denominator, so we have to somehow cancel it. How can we cancel it? Well, by multiplying this z2 by its complex conjugate. Because like this, we know it's a real number. It's the sum of the square of the real and imaginary part. Both of them, real and imaginary part, are real. Therefore, the sum of the square is also real. So that it remains equal, I have, of course, to multiply both numerator and denominator by the same quantity. Yeah? Like this, the equality stays the same. So now we compute. So I substitute, and we start to be to get used to this complex algebra. And z2 is by definition x2 plus iy2, x2 minus iy2. So we could compute everything slowly, but as we start to get familiar with the thing, we can go fast. We know that z2 star is equal to the modulus square, which is the sum of the square. So I can write directly like this. But you can check, you can expand again. I mean, it's just repeating what we did before. We are going to do as well very fast. The numerator is x1, x2. Then I will have the plus y1, y2. That's the real part. And for the complex part, the imaginary part, I will make a bit of room there. This is the part that comes with I that we are going to factorize. So it's x2, y1 minus x1, y2. And this solves our problem, because you see that A is this part and B is this part. So we have to keep the numerator for both. And indeed, x1, x2, y1, y2 being all real number, with the denominator x2 squared plus y2 squared not being 0, because we cannot divide by 0, we don't want z2 to be 0, therefore this denominator is not 0. So this quantity, like the red part, this ratio x1, x2 plus y1, y2 divided by x2 squared plus y2 squared, is a real number. And the same for the b, which is this over quantity. I'm not reading aloud, but you got it written there. Therefore, that's it. We demonstrated that the ratio is, the inverse, is a complex number. So for instance, what is 1 over I? We do the same trick. We multiply numerator and denominator by complex conjugate. Complex conjugate of I is minus I by definition. I times minus I, we already seen before, is equal to plus 1. Or we can look at it as modulus square, so it's 1 square plus 0 square for the real part plus 1 square, that's 1, and we got minus I. So an important thing, the inverse of I is the opposite of I, something that you don't get in the real algebra. Important quantity that we are going to use many times. And again, I like to check that this property also apply or generalize to over quantity. So you can look now at the inverse of the square of a complex number, and all these operations remain complex. So this is well behaved and consistent in this case. So far, this is all for addition, multiplication. We just look at division, which is the multiplication by the inverse. But you might ask, does it still carry on like this? Could we look at more sophisticated algebraic notion, like the square root? We spent a lot of time already discussing the square root of 2. What about the concept, something like the square root of I? Or does it stop there, complex algebra? Does it stop our multiplication and addition? Interestingly, no, it doesn't stop. We can go till the very end of it. We are not going to do it today, because we still need to introduce these functions for the real variable first, but we will look at the cosine and the sine of the complex number and the exponential of complex, logarithm of complex number. Any function you care to, or about the real variable, they can be extended in a very useful way to the complex variable. And actually, we'll see that they are better defined, they are more naturally defined with the complex variable than with the real variable, which tends to show that the real quantity actually, so it shows again that the terminology is not the best. The important quantity, the actual quantity, the genuine quantity is the complex variable, not the real variable, which is a particular case. But let's come back to the square root of I. This we are going to look at today. The question becomes, what is square root of I? Is it a complex number? which means is it of this form a plus ib or x plus iy. It doesn't matter the notation. What is the definition of square root? We said by applying this Carnot principle that we just extend the rules of algebra that we are familiar with to this new concept, to this new object. This is the quantity which multiplied by itself is equal to the radicand, which is I. Therefore, it is the quantity which multiplied by itself, taking the square, is equal to I. Can we find A and B that satisfy that? Can we compute? This is A square minus B square plus I AB, which happens in two possible ways. So we could put the 2 before the complex number itself. I mean, we could write I2AB or 2IAB because there is the commutativity. But somehow it's better to keep the convention, I believe, is more popular to have the numbers that are arithmetically defined to appear before the letter itself. So this should be equal to I. Can we find A and B that satisfy this? Two complex numbers are equal when their real parts and their imaginary part are equal. So this is an equivalence, which means, so this is Z2, Z2. Let me make sure that everything is clear and well written. And here we've got the AND, the logical AND. So I can write it like this as you want. So it means it goes in this way and in this way. Remember the notation. So for this to be equal, the real part should be equal. What is the real part? On the left is a square minus b square, the part that comes without the I. On the right, this is zero, because I has no real part. This is a so-called pure imaginary number. And then what are the imaginary parts? Remember, we don't keep the I, so it's 2ab equal 1. Now, can we solve this equation? Well, actually, it's quite easy to solve this equation. We already seen the trick that the difference of square is equal to the product of the difference and the sum. So I keep the second equal. And we said that a product of two quantities is equal to zero if and only if, so against an equivalence, it goes in the two sense, one or the other term is equal to zero. So that makes for two solutions. One, when this thing is equal to zero, and that gives us this case, a minus b equal to 0 and 2ab is equal to 1. Or the other is equal to 0, and that gives us this case, which is a is equal to minus b and 2ab is equal to 1. And now it's easy to solve this. If I, let's take the first one, for instance, I substitute it there. We've got 2a squared equal 1, so a squared equal 1 over square root of 2, and b is equal to a, first equation, so also 1 over square root of 2. So if I didn't make a mistake in my algebra, this number, 1 over square root of 2 that I can factorize 1 plus I, is the square root of i. We can check. Once we find something, if we can, it's nice to check. Let's take the square of this quantity. The square root of 2 becomes 1 half. 1 plus I square is 1 square, which is 1, plus I square, which is minus 1, and the double product is 2i. And you see that this cancel, the 2 cancel, and we are left with I. So it works. I let you solve the other equation. You will find the same, but with the opposite sign, which shows us that there are two complex numbers, which are the square root of I, two complex numbers I can multiply to themselves to give I. And this is actually something that was already the case with the real variable. When we solve this equation, x square equal 2, we actually have two solutions, which is x equal plus or minus square root of 2. So we keep the plus solution, because it's easy, when you've got plus or minus, it's easy to find which one is positive. In the complex number, it is not so simple, because the complex number, they don't have this property, this relationship to the zero than the other numbers are. We cannot say the complex number is positive or negative, because is I larger than zero, smaller. This question doesn't have a sense. So it's more subtle, more sophisticated, more complicated, the situation of complex number. It's something that we will leave later when we define the principal branch and how to choose the good number when there is various solutions that various numbers that are solutions to an equation. But so far, the main point is that what I wanted to convince you of is that we can indeed consider that the square root of I is complex in the sense that it exists in this form. I can find a plus ib, such as the square, is equal to I. And again, I will let you check things like for yourself that all the square root of any complex number, so the a plus ib in general, is also a complex number. I leave you this as an exercise. For now, what I want to discuss instead than going further into this this analysis, this calculation, or making more advanced calculation of complex number, is try to emphasize the interest or the importance of this complex number for physics. They happen to be more important, in fact, than the real numbers. In some context, like for instance, when we describe a microscopic object, like an electron will find is not described in terms of real numbers, unlike in Newtonian mechanics, when you throw balls, this is described by real numbers. It's momentum and its position, and all these are real numbers. You can measure them with a stick. But when you look at more fundamental objects in a microscopic scale, here we find that we need to describe objects with complex numbers. And why is this so? It is so because complex numbers, when we write them like this, as x plus iy, it is not innocent that we choose this letter x and y to represent the real and imaginary part of the complex number. I told you before that we use x and y, that's the convention that was proposed by Descartes, a really nice one. We use the end of the alphabet letters to denote unknown quantities which you have to solve for. While we use the beginning of the alphabet letter, a and b, alpha, beta with the Greek alphabet, for variables. So that's algebra replacing arithmetic, but they are supposed to be known anyway, these quantities. Even though they are general, they are unknown. So why do we choose x and y here? This is because when we write a function, you certainly know that we tend to use for the horizontal axis the variable x, and for the vertical axis the variable y. And the complex number z, indeed, we can use the horizontal axis to represent the real part, and the vertical axis to represent the imaginary part. So if I've got our quantity of before, 1 over square root of 2, 1 plus I, let's look at this 1 plus I, for instance, so I can label my x, 1, 2, 3, we've got the negative number that go in the over direction, the same here, we've got minus 1, minus 2, 1, 2, so on and so forth, the 0 is at the center of our axis, and there's the 1 plus I, it's this number, here I've got the complex number that is here. 1 plus I. I itself, I can put it in red because it's so important, that's the new quantity we have there, is the one unit on the vertical axis. So that's what the complex number do, they open a new dimension. Instead of being on the real line of numbers, now we have got two axes and we can go vertically. That's what the complex number add. So minus I is here, that's minus I. Let's come back to the normal letter. We've got minus 1, of course, and a generic number, a plus ib, ab, a plus ib, that's the generic quantum complex number. And why are they so important for physics, I was telling you? Because this so-called Cartesian representation, in terms of the real horizontal and imaginary vertical coordinate, we can also equivalently look at it differently in terms of the so-called polar representation. The polar representation, it replaces the x and y projection by a so-called distance, and the distance we know what it is already, this is the modulus, the square root of zz star, let me write it like this, zz star, remove this bar there, and an angle, the angle I will put in different color, so we see it, this angle, theta. So a plus ib, we can write it as the modulus of z, so a plus ib times, I will need more space, I will copy it there, without the axis, a plus ib times cos theta plus I sine theta. Or we can distribute this a plus ib, which I will do it for being exhaustive, trying to win a bit of space, bit of time, I move this here and I copy this one there. Here we go. Of course, we have to be careful to keep all the parentheses. Okay. So here this is real. There is a I, but it is enclosed by this absolute value, this modulus, which remember transform the complex number into a real distance. And here we've got the I that brings us into the vertical axis. So this polar representation is very important. because that allows us to deal with numbers that have an angle, or what we like to call in physics a phase. And phase is really important because that's what describes basically a wave. A wave is an amplitude, a distance, and a phase. So complex numbers are really used in things like optics or quantum mechanics. It's used to describe the electron, as I was telling you before, because the electron, modern physics tells us, happens to be a wave. Not a wave like the optics wave, or like the wave of sound, or the wave of vibration on a string. It's a wave of a probability, amplitude. So it's quite an abstract concept that needs a lot of understanding and formalization. But this is for second semester. The most important now is for you to realize that in physics, complex numbers are at the center of a lot of modern theories, not even modern theories. When you are going to look at diffraction, for instance, you are going to add several waves that are diffracted in different directions, and all this is done very easily with the complex number. So here, a comment on the terminology is in order. We call them complex number, but this is really unfortunate because there is nothing complicated about them. The choice of the word complex is really unfortunate. As well, imaginary, the part which goes with the I, we call that the imaginary part, or imaginary number. This is also unfortunate because there is nothing imaginary about them. They are as real than the real number, or the other numbers, the natural numbers. Everything is invented, is conceptualized in the Platonic universe, but already has otherwise the same existence. And to convince you further about the existence, in the sense that they are there independently of definition or choices or Cardano's whim to write the square root and carry on the algebra, that there is a structure which is there before Cardano and after Cardano, that is there for us to discover, and if someone wants to keep it secret, someone else will come and arrive at the same conclusion. I want to show you something really interesting, which is also really recent. It's the beginning of the 20th century. It was found by a French mathematician by the name of Mandelbrot. And it's quite surprising because it's both extremely rich, extremely recent, modern, but also extremely simple, because it consists in taking a complex number in the plane, C there, so something of the form A plus IB, where A is the horizontal projection and B the vertical projection. And we apply a simple iterative map. Iterative, it means that we do it, we keep doing it, we repeat the operation. An operation is this one. So that's our first step, z0, then we define z1. We take the square of our previous step, so I'm squaring z0, and we add the constant that we chose at the beginning. So I iterate that, z2 becomes z1 square plus c, z3 becomes z2 square plus c. Then you see the generic pattern, of course, is zn plus 1 equals zn square plus c. And then two things can happen if you do that, which is easy to compute. I mean, it might be a bit tedious. I encourage you to do it by hand. Like this, you can practice your complex algebra, but a computer is particularly suitable to do that. So you have to compute c squared plus c. That becomes z0, z1 squared. So z1 is c squared plus c. We have to take the square and we add c. Then that becomes c squared plus c squared plus c. I have to square and I add c. I hope you see what I'm doing. I'm just substituting. You can check slowly and substitute C for an actual number like I or 1. The real number is a complex number, of course. Remember that R is included in C. Now we just extended our collection of numbers. And two things can happen with this series of numbers, Z0, Z1, Z2, Zn. It can happen that if you look at the point, so that would be Z0, then maybe Z1 here, Z2, Z3, Z4, I don't know where they are, but I'm not computing. We can ask the computer to do this. And this series of points, it can remain bounded, which means that I can find a circle that will enclose all the Zn. All the Zn are in a circle of given radius. It can become very wide, this circle. You see, it's getting outside of my screen. It can become really wide, but it exists a radius that will enclose all my points. In which case, this is the case, our initial point C, we will paint in red. Or it can happen the other thing, the other situation, that instead of doing this, if I take another point, so we'll start there, it will oscillate as well, it will produce new number, but in number they will tend to grow and they will go farther and farther. So we'll have to zoom out, and then this point will go very far, and they will diverge, which means that I will not be able to find a radius, a circle. However big is the radius, there will always be a point that will fall outside of this radius. If this is the case, this constant that we took initially, this C, will not paint at all. Like this, we will get only, if we scan now, for all the points of the complex plane, we can have, we'll have two colors, red or white. And if you do this, this is what you find. That's the structure that a computer has calculated. He took all the points, he iterated this procedure, and he finds this surprisingly complex structure. It's quite interesting because you see that there is a structure, definitely. There is this little dendrite, there is all these circles, there is this very beautiful pattern. The most surprising now is that this is for a given resolution of taking the point, but if you zoom, now I show you another cases with colors, I will tell you what the colors correspond to. So here we are zooming into the structure, still applying these same rules, but we are taking numbers with much more decimals all the time, much more accuracy, because we are restricting to smaller and smaller parts of the complex plane. We find that this structure never ends. So first, it's very beautiful, it's very pretty. It's, no artist before Mandelbrot even came to conceive of this geometry, of this shape. It's surprisingly complex. There's a lot of information. They tell us something about the processes of square. It's a squaring number. It's multiplying things by themselves over and over again. And the last thing is that it never stops. So it repeats to itself. You see, there's this self-similarity because we see things that are reminiscent, or they remind us of something we've seen before, or it could even be more original. If you look at different points of the plane, you will discover a new structure. So in this sense, there is a Platonic universe, because this is not something that anybody invented. It's not Mandelbrot or Cardano or anybody who could have even the beginning of the idea of such a complicated structure. It's something which is there. And wherever there is a civilization that is advanced enough to deal with this concept of algebra, for sure they discover this concept of complex number because they are universal. At some point when you need to solve the quadratic equation, you will discover these quantities. You will find the discriminant that is negative, which means that you don't have real valued solution, you have complex valued solution of your quadratic equation. Quadratic equation always have two solutions, always, but the solution can be degenerate or they can be complex, but it's exactly two solutions. Degenerate, it means it's twice the same solution. And this thing is independent of us. It exists if there is a different planet somewhere else where people are advanced enough to do anything, they will have found this. In this sense, that shows that there is an existence of the Platonic universe, because it is not physical. Yeah? In the physical universe, you cannot keep digging and going smaller and smaller into the complex plane, because you will hit the minimum distance of the atoms or the quarks, or really, if you want to go really small, you will hit the Planck's length, which is the smallest length that we know of, 10⁻¹⁵ meters, if you remember our first lecture on the orders of magnitude. And then it stops. There is no more structure. In the Platonic universe, it goes on forever. And we are only limited by our ability to have the computer handle numbers with ever-growing number of digits to correspond to this, to the amount of zoom that we want to look at. But we know mathematically that it never stops. So it keeps repeating. It flows this information, this structure, this pattern. They keep pouring at you if you go there. And you can understand very easily that there is a lot of place in this complex plane where you can go and explore, and nobody will have been there before. It's an infinite space that is full of things to look at and to explore. This is for the square, and we have other structure, other geometry that correspond to the cube or other operation. So all this should demonstrate to you the power, the substantiability, I mean, that is consubstantial, it exists by itself, so the reality of the complex number. So you see again that the terminology is really unfortunate. You shouldn't call them complex number or imaginary number. It would be much better to call them geometric number or phase number or trigonometric number, because they are related to the trigonometric function, as we will see later on. Their most useful purpose for us will be to simplify considerably operations we do on the circle. But otherwise, more than that, it should convince you that there is a lot of beautiful things to explore with very simple elementary processes, operations. Algebra on I, we just add this new quantity I square equal minus 1. If we crankle the machine to apply all our algebraic rules to that, this is the structure that we discover. And this is the structure which is left to you, left for you to explore.